At the Keck Observatory in Hawaii, which houses one of the largest telescopes in the world, GES began using a groundbreaking technology called adaptive optics, which brings into focus faraway objects.
So this is without adaptive optics. This is what you would see. In this big square, there's nothing. We turn adaptive optics on, and you see the stars. This region contains the stars that provide the keys to our experiment. So we want to watch how these stars move.
So GES noticed that there was a large cluster of stars orbiting around an invisible object at the center of our galaxy. And they were moving at an unusually rapid rate.
So we can actually see these stars that are really close to the center, and we can watch them go around. Those stars go around the black hole just the way the planets orbit the sun. The orbits tell us where the black hole is, so it's located right where the star is. That's the center of our galaxy. And the details of exactly how fast these stars are going around and how tight the orbits are tells us the mass of the black hole, which we think today is 4 million times the mass of our sun.
For GES, confirming that a supermassive black hole indeed exists at the heart of our galaxy was like summiting Mount Everest.
It was incredibly exciting to discover the supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy, simply because it was a question we had set out to address. The question, is there a supermassive black hole? We could design an experiment that actually got at it.
Astrophysicist Andrew Hamilton says death by a supermassive black hole would be much different than by a smaller stellar mass relative.
If you want to go and be a tourist and have the ultimate experience of falling inside a black hole and finding out what's really there, go visit a supermassive black hole. Much better idea.
Unlike a stellar black hole, which would rip you to shreds before entering its deadly vortex, a space explorer could actually experience free-falling inside a supermassive black hole.
Inside a supermassive black hole, it turns out that even though the black hole is more massive, it's also much larger in size, and that means that the tidal forces are weak enough that you could pass through the event horizon and fall deep inside the black hole without being tidally torn apart. But deep down inside the black hole, the centrifugal force of the rotation of the black hole provides effectively a repulsion. If there's any matter at all inside it, then stuff that's falling in will tend to collide with stuff that's trying to get out. And the result of that collision of energies is an unimaginably chaotic maelstrom of super hot, dense plasma. And in that case, your fate is that it can roast you.
So how close would space travelers have to be to get sucked into a supermassive black hole in the center of a galaxy?
For a supermassive black hole, you would have to be about a million to a billion miles from the black hole to feel its influence.
Over the years, the Chandra X-ray Observatory has caught our galaxy's supermassive black hole nibbling on cosmic matter, not binging like other supermassive black holes.
Our black hole is today inactive compared to other black holes. Our galaxy has very little gas at the center, and so there's nothing really for the black hole to feed on.
It's not eating very much. It's going on a bit of a starvation diet.
Our galaxy's supermassive black hole appears to be fasting. This is partly due to the fact that as a galaxy ages, less and less matter is present for it to gorge on.
But in the future, it might be quite a bit more active if it ever gets a fresh supply of gas at its center to feed off of.
One way to rejuvenate our supermassive black hole's appetite is to collide with another galaxy. Sound implausible? 2 million light years away, our closest neighbor, the Andromeda Galaxy, is charging toward us at almost 75 miles per second, or 270,000 miles per hour. In the future, scientists predict the two galaxies will collide. And upon impact, the larger galaxy may engage in one of the most primitive acts known in the universe. It's one of the most barbaric rituals in space. A larger galaxy eats a smaller one. The scenario isn't a science fiction writer's fantasy. It's a cosmic reality. It's called galactic cannibalism. The ghastly event can occur on the celestial highway when two galaxies have a head-on collision. Both eventually meld together in a less than harmonious merger.
If you're a galaxy, it's very violent. You're torn to shreds.
Joshua Barnes studies galaxy mergers. Acting like a crime scene investigator, he admits his research is a bit like inspecting a car crash.
Imagine that you come across the scene of a car crash. Two wrecked vehicles, but no witnesses. Nobody to tell you what happened. All you have is the physical evidence. That's basically what we have to do when we study colliding galaxies. So there are no witnesses to a galactic collision. All that you have is the present state of the wreckage. So you have to conduct a sort of forensic investigation to try and figure out what happened on the basis of what you have today. If they collided head-on, you would know because the fronts were squashed up, but if they, say, sideswiped each other, which is actually more likely in galactic collisions, that would leave you a completely different pattern of wreckage, and you could interpret that.
So what causes galaxy mergers?
It's gravity. Everything in the universe is falling freely through space. And where you've got two large objects like galaxies, their mutual gravity pulls them together, so they fall into each other. So it's really just the force of gravity pulling things around. The galaxies that we're seeing colliding today, most of them have been bound and destined to collide for upwards of 10, 15 billion years, and they're only now just making it to that first collision.
Our own galaxy, the Milky Way, is moving toward our neighbor, Andromeda. Both galaxies are spiral in shape, but Andromeda is about twice as massive, with a supermassive black hole, the mass of 30 million suns.
It'll look a lot like a dance. And you see the two galaxies come close together, so they kind of dance around each other, getting closer and closer and moving faster and faster before they finally come together.
But at the point of impact, these galactic dancers will do more than pirouette.
Each one has a spiral disk of stars, and then surrounding that, a halo of dark matter, invisible material that we can detect by its gravitational field. These two dark halos, which are much larger, will overlap as the galaxies pass by. Eventually, as the two galaxies spiral around each other closer and closer, you can no longer distinguish them as separate systems, and finally the nuclei merge.
When Andromeda and the Milky Way collide, that's going to be the biggest collision that the Milky Way has seen, something like 5 billion years' time. The good news is that we, the solar system, will have a grandstand view. What will happen is that two galaxies, their spiral disks, are going to get tidally torn apart into fantastical shapes.
When the disks start to get close to each other, they'll throw off long streamers of stars, so-called tidal tails. And what happens to the sun and the solar system should we still be around, it really is hard to predict. We could get lucky and be on one of those tidal tails and get a sort of bird's eye view of the whole process as we fly out. Or we could get thrown into an orbit plunging towards the center of the merging galaxies. There's basically no way to say.
During the merger, if our solar system moves through the suburbs or the edges of Andromeda, we might not notice anything. On the other hand, countless stars and space material could be propelled towards the planets, potentially disrupting their orbits around the sun. Moreover, the entire galaxy could face cosmic upheaval.
We could have consequences which would nonetheless be dangerous. First of all, we could have a lot of star formation as a consequence of the merger. Currently, both the Milky Way and Andromeda galaxy have plenty of interstellar gas, the raw material from which stars are born.